Once, we were so many, we couldn't be counted. For some of our clans, life began in high mountain birth houses. Others, through tundra to great inland nurseries. But for all, the path from birth has always been the same. We follow the cold trickles that become creeks, that grow to great rivers and run out to the sea. At the end of our lives, we return to the river and sacrifice our bodies so life can carry on, as it always has.
We had an agreement once, you and I. You took only what you needed from our populations for food, protected our spawning grounds.
And we agreed to come back year after year and sustain you. We used to swim wild in great numbers in the currents of the Atlantic. You blocked our rivers so we couldn't return to spawn, fouled them, and netted too many of us. Soon we were all but gone. For a time, we surged in the eastern rivers of America in numbers so vast we were fed to pigs as an afterthought. You chose once more to block our upstream passage, poison our spawning beds, and take far too many of us for your own needs. For thousands of years, the rivers of the Pacific coast teemed with our bodies. And again, you thought we were of infinite supply. Our numbers shrank while your numbers grew. We had an agreement once, you and I. Once there was a fisherman who caught a small fry. The tiny salmon pleaded for his life, saying, "I'm a small meal now, but put me back and I'll return large enough to feed you properly." The fisherman replied, "How foolish I should be to throw you back if I were to forego my certain gain for an uncertain future."
Every time I send a line down, I never know what's going to come to the surface. That's the draw. It's eternally new, this anticipation of what's down there.
Not ready. There you go. Oh yeah. Look at that. Yeah.
Thank you, little brother. Thank you.
Ding, baby.
Nice fish, brother.
Ah, Chinook.
My fascination with salmon began pretty early. I caught my first king salmon when I was 2 years old. Well, Dad caught it. I chucked my brand new fishing pole at it. Lost the pole. Didn't matter. I was hooked. I chased salmon around my whole childhood, right up until I discovered girls. I rediscovered my passion for fishing after college when I went to work as a guide in Alaska. I spent my 20s with a singular mission: find salmon. And I did, a lot of them. and I thought I knew every last thing there was to know about them. Until one day, I picked up a book I should have read when it came out in 1981. It was a game changer. I learned about legendary 100-pound king salmon from the Elwha River in my home state of Washington. 100 pounds. These giants returned to the Elwha for thousands of years, then suddenly disappeared almost overnight. I dug in to learn more and discovered how much I didn't know about this fish I'd been obsessed with since I was a kid. Turns out the Elwha River salmon shared the same fate as their cousins, who once filled rivers across Europe and North America, then slowly disappeared. What I'd been learning spoke of overfishing, dams, ruined habitat, hatcheries, and fish farms, but also of an extraordinary place that has the last best wild salmon runs left. I'd happily stalked these fish most of my life, caught, killed, and eaten hundreds, maybe thousands of them. But the joy I felt when connected to one by a 9-foot hunk of graphite was changing somehow. So I set a course that would take me up the West Coast through once legendary salmon country, clear to the last remaining salmon strongholds in Alaska, to find out if it's truly possible to fix what's been broken, and if there's hope for the wild fish that remain. First up, best person I could think of to help me start unraveling these questions.
But yeah, this is really, it just weighs nothing.
David James Duncan wrote a book called The River Why that inspired my 18-year-old self to pursue big fish and answers to even bigger questions. Its young protagonist, Gus, set out on a quest to fish a river endlessly. What Gus found instead of just fishing nirvana was an encounter with the other side, with something eternal by connecting with one exceptional wild salmon. As a 5-year-old boy, David James Duncan received his glimpse of a messenger from the other side inside the golden eye of a lone coho. Ankarinkis Kisuch, a wild silver salmon, rising from the pool of a junky, poisoned 26-mile stream that runs through Portland, Oregon, Johnson Creek.
It was an Indian summer day in late September, and I was in the center of what has become Gresham, Oregon, and this big coho glided up, just glided right below me in the pool, and their eyes don't blink, and it just looked into me in a way that I really felt it saw depths in me that I had previously been unaware of possessing.
Johnson Creek runs for 26 miles through Portland, Oregon. It passes by 200,000 homes on its way to the Willamette River.
And there was just a lot of shit in the creek, you know? I mean, shopping carts were fairly routine, old appliances, tires, tin cans, needles, probably a dead body or three somewhere in there, because it wasn't healthy enough to support trout or really any other kind of living, breathing creature at that time.
We started doing cleanups about 15 years ago. Every single article about Johnson Creek always has a shopping cart in it, in the photo, and that always bugs me, but it's true. Every year we find, you know, something like about 13 shopping carts back in Johnson Creek at every cleanup. So, you know, slowly we're cleaning up Johnson Creek. It's important to have healthy wildlife, a little bit of wild in the cities, or people aren't going to know what wild is anymore. In 2010, there were a few people out walking the Springwater Corridor trails, and their dog found a carcass. And that was the first time a coho carcass had been found in Johnson Creek in about 20 years. And we had some intrepid volunteers, and they went out there and they found more.
So it's gonna be worth it to restore Johnson Creek, and every other little marginal, denigrated, damaged creek in the country deserves our best shot at making it healthy enough for kids to go play next to it.
I mean, I've just seen people, you know, ecstatic when they've brought little runs of chum salmon back to 10-mile-long streams in Washington State where there were no salmon for 50 years or 75 years. When you see these big backs coming out of the water in a small stream, I mean, big fish in small water, it's just, that's a hereafter in the here for me. There's something heavenly about seeing this gift come physical. There it is.
Four coho returned to Johnson Creek in the fall of 2013. Four fish aren't the answer for the return of a species. But the thousands of eyes that see those four fish, maybe. These fish are icons in the Pacific Northwest. In their vast numbers, salmon long ago built this place.
If you think of rivers and tributaries as sort of capillaries in a body, you know, you can look at your hands and see these capillaries. You know, you think of salmon moving into all of those and distributing nutrients throughout that system. They basically feed the whole ecosystem.
If you can imagine them coming down the coast and just turning on the growth, the lights, the green.
137 different creatures depend on salmon in one form or another.
A bear takes a carcass into the woods. The roots of the terrestrial vegetation, the riparian vegetation, take that up. They grow leaves. Insects feed on those leaves. They drop in the water. The young fish feed on those.
They are the principal way that nature returns nutrients to the land. We live in a part of the world where rain is the predominant meteorological phenomenon. Every other major process here strips the land of nutrients and runs them out to the sea. The salmon collect nutrients in the North Pacific in the great planktonic gyres, and they bring the nutrients back. And that's what makes this world stable and rich. And that's why the salmon matter.
Salmon bring one more thing to this region.
Their food.
For tens of centuries, wild salmon came in such great number that it fed more people than all the corn, wheat, pigs, cat, everything we've done since.
I had salmon to eat every day as a child. I'm 22 years old, and something that my generation's starting to figure out is the fact that we really need to take some responsibility for where food comes from.
And these salmon have been feeding us. And there's more and more and more and more of us on this planet, and we can't get that in control. We better start paying attention to the refrigerator.
If you look 100 years down the road, which to a geologist is like not much time at all, and you think about how will people look at salmon, it's gonna be viewed as one of the most incredible food sources on the planet. It's incredibly nutritious, full of omega-3s. It's, you know, one of the best foods you can eat, and it grows itself. Throwing away a resource like that for short-term interests makes no sense.
And what? This is the best food in the planet for you. I'm having salmon again tonight.
But let's say you're not from the Pacific Northwest. Imagine this. You live near a river. Every year, without fail, you make your way to the riverbank, and a barge shows up, delivering you a freezer full of free steaks. Steaks. Steaks for you, your whole family, all your neighbors. Behind that barge is another, carrying the world's best fertilizer. If steaks aren't your thing, this fertilizer can grow your crops like nobody's business. It'll feed all the insects, trout, bass, and most every animal near the river, even the trees that shade its water and anchor its banks. But with salmon, instead of barges, all the steak and fertilizer are rolled up into one tiny fire red orb, an egg. Peering out from the gravel of a cold river, she hatches, looking more like a young extraterrestrial than a salmon. She's called an alevin at this stage and will live off the yolk sac from her egg for several weeks, when she'll emerge from the gravel as a fry. When her body's prepared to switch from freshwater to saltwater, she's called a smolt and heads out to the great mystery of the sea. Thousands of miles out in the North Pacific, she'll eat and gain weight, then return with all the sea's wealth inside her to the same river, the same spot she was born to complete one last act. She'll spawn and die and give life to a new generation. And then it all begins again, every year without fail.
There was a river that ran steep and cold into the Pacific. Our largest kings returned here for thousands of years. One day, the way upstream was blocked by an impassable stone wall. There was no way over or around or through it, no matter how hard the large ones slammed their bodies into it. So we just let our eggs and our lives go. Right there at the base of that wall. Soon these walls started to grow in most of our rivers. Some we could pass, some we could not. All of your overfishing cannot compare to the numbers we lost when these came to be.
The Elwha drains out of the Olympic Mountains in the northwest corner of my home state. It plunges swift and steep for 45 miles, and that's why many believe the big kings came back here. They had to be that big to make it home through those torrents to spawn. Ankarinkas Chawicha, Chinook or Chun hogs as they were known in the Elwha, would reach 100 pounds or more. But all that changed in 1913, when the first of two dams was built on the lower Elwha River.
These dams were built without any kind of fish passage. So there was a law on the books at the time in the state of Washington that said that fish passage needed to be included in any new dam construction. That just didn't happen here.
And this is a problem for the new governor, Ernest Lister, I think his name was. And his fish commissioner, his last name, I think, oddly enough, was Darwin, came up with a solution for them. And the solution was that the dam it could be considered an official state-sanctioned obstruction if they built a fish hatchery and connected it physically to the dam.
In other words, we're willing to accept a salmon hatchery in lieu of steps necessary to maintain the wild runs. There was no reason to believe this would work, but the state went for it.
And the hatchery failed and was abandoned 7 years later. Despite this failure, the trade set a precedent that would be repeated on Northwest salmon rivers for decades to come. When industry needed a river, industry got a river, and hatcheries enabled this. And the wild salmon began to disappear.
The Elwha people, in their language, call themselves Ch'etlwa Nustlaim. Etlwa Nustlaim. And it stands for the strong people. Sometimes in the summer, we'd swim across the river on the back of our horses, bareback. And I just love that memory of being able to do that and going down to the river when they're spawning, seeing the salmon as they're spawning, you know. So it was just fascinating to see these big fish and know that they're laying these eggs and then they die. It was hard as a young person to understand that cycle and that sacredness of their giving their life to continue that cycle.
The Elwha people's struggle to return their home, culture, and way of life was just as strong as the hearts of the giant kings who disappeared on that river a century before. Russ Bush was the attorney for the Elwha people and my friend. For more than three decades, Russ and many others worked tirelessly in an unprecedented fight to remove the Elwha's two salmon-blocking dams.
I think it was 1976 when I first got the case. As more and more people got involved and Congress got involved, I began to see what was going on. Meanwhile, the tribe, which always knew how important the dams were, started to want to go ahead. Then I kind of realized there's a whole lot of people that want these dams out of there. And then as I gained more knowledge and the tribe trusted me more, then I started to really get into it.
This was one of the early dam removal controversies. Nowadays you hear about dam removal. It's in the common vernacular nationwide, but back then...
You know, that was like a concept that people laughed at. What? Why would you do that? Because when they put the dams in, that's when Western Washington could grow. Cities like Port Angeles and Bremerton and industries could take off, like logging.
This event is a gift, and this day is a gift. The tallest dam upriver that has ever been removed. And we're going to celebrate this today.
The battle to remove the Elwha's dams took nearly four decades. Toward the end, Russ fought a battle of his own with cancer and finally came to rest in April of 2012. But not before he saw the lower dam come out with his own eyes. You cannot come to this place and see this river flowing free again without feeling a profound sense of hope. In the summer of 2012, wild king salmon returned to spawn in the free-flowing Elwha River for the first time in 100 years.
I'm very happy that the dams are coming out, but all those years of hardship still embeds in my mind how the old people had to live after their main food was taken away. It should be a time of healing for all of us and reaching out to each other, helping each other, everyone, not just the Elwha Klallam, but all the people that live near the Elwha River, so that as we move forward to the next 100 years, we don't make the same mistakes again, and we grow together in a healthy way.
In 2013, over 3,500 king salmon returned to the Elwha, more than had been counted in decades. But still a fraction of the over 400,000 salmon a year that used to return to the river before the dams were built. Hatcheries emerged from a belief that human technology could mitigate for the devastation we've inflicted on salmon and their spawning rivers by simply making more fish. Stocks are created by killing returning adult females, harvesting their eggs, and fertilizing them with sperm from returning males. After incubating and hatching, the offspring are raised in captivity until they are ready to migrate to the ocean.
You are clever, and that's why you thrive. But do you truly believe you could manufacture something that's taken tens of thousands of cold winter gestations and torrential spring runoffs and endless summer leaps to perfect? You mined the eggs from our bellies, and you put them in the wrong rivers. Cleverness is not wisdom.
The genius of wild salmon is that each run has perfectly adapted through the ages to the conditions in their own home river. Bigger river, bigger fish, longer river, fattier fish, and so on. This genetic diversification is what has allowed wild fish to survive ice ages, volcanoes, and periodic bad ocean conditions for eons. Now, no one in the Pacific Northwest would have much salmon to catch at all without a dependence on hatcheries as a lifeline for salmon runs, even on the Elwha. The plan is to supplement the population with hatchery fish while waiting for the wild stocks to recover during the restoration process and slowly fade the hatchery out. But no one really knows how long this might take.
We're off balance. The natural world is off balance. To mitigate for salmon, you have to build hatcheries. And all of these rivers have hatcheries on them. In the Puget Sound and the Pacific Coast, we depend on hatcheries. Hatchery salmon is the most important thing to our tribes.
Hatcheries have not been able to restore salmon populations to what they once were. It's clear they provide fish to catch, but they also provide risks to remnant wild runs. Hatchery and wild fish compete for the same limited food source and the same habitat. Hatchery fish can carry disease, and they're not as genetically sophisticated. This weakens their wild cousins' gene pool if they interbreed. Despite these risks, here we are.
There's no easy picture here. You know, it's going to take us 100 years to put this habitat back.
The removal of the dams on the Elwha is a breathtaking victory for wild salmon. But if we want them to return in their historically great numbers, there's more work to be done. The Columbia River was once considered the mightiest salmon stronghold in the world. The Snake River is the Columbia's largest tributary. Four dams built during the Cold War cut off thousands of miles of pristine salmon habitat.
When an 8-inch-long salmon smolt used to travel to sea, it was washed down there backwards, just feeding on little bits of things, or fast, most of them fast, for that great part of their journey. When the slack waters were put in, 450 miles of dead water, they had to turn around and swim, so they're being emaciated because their instinct is to fast. They come up on a dam, they're swimming in 10 to 20 feet of water. They're suddenly knocked down to a depth of 110 feet. They come out through the turbines and all of a sudden are in zero depth. So at every dam, the smolts are killed by the bends, by nitrogen poisoning. And to get from the interior of Idaho and eastern Washington and eastern Oregon, you have to go through that process 8 times. But there are 5,500 miles of rivers and pristine salmon nurseries, beautiful birth houses, sitting there in wild Idaho, eastern Oregon, wilderness, most of it, waiting for this one move. Four dams, bink, 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 bink.
Time to head north. Next stop, the Broughton Archipelago in British Columbia, Canada. The Broughton is a wild stretch of islands and fjords off the northeast tip of Vancouver Island. It is also host to 120 commercial fish farms, with up to 24 net pens per farm, holding thousands of Atlantic salmon per net pen. Salmon farms are different than land-based salmon hatcheries. Hatcheries raise juvenile Pacific salmon in a controlled environment, then send them out to sea with the hope that they return as adults. Fish farms raise foreign Atlantic salmon in open saltwater net pens, where they spend their whole lives in captivity. When mature, farm salmon are butchered and sold as food. All 5 species of wild Pacific salmon migrate past these pens, including pinks, or humpies. Oncorhynchus gorbushka are the smallest of the Pacific salmon species, but they've come to play a large role in Alexandra Morton's research and activism over the last 26 years. Alex is an independent biologist who lives in the Broughton Archipelago.
So the tides are the lungs, and they're breathing in and out. And the wild salmon are the bloodstream, and they're going in and out to all these rivers. They carry the ocean nutrients up. Every single migration route for wild salmon is now blocked by these feedlots.
Alexandra Morton moved to the Broughton Archipelago in 1984 while studying whales and quickly called it home. In 1986, her husband Robin tragically drowned while filming underwater. Alex decided to stay on and continued her research while raising a family as a single mom. When fish farms moved in during the early 90s, they used audio devices to scare the whales away from their net pens. It worked, and the whales didn't return. From that point on, Alex turned her attention to fish farms and how they were introducing an industrial footprint into what was pristine habitat for whales and wild salmon.
I first came into Fife Sound in October 1984 and followed whales in, which is how I found this place. And this right here is like the hub of a wheel. And I lived right over there. I still have my research station there. For a whale to get anywhere, they had to pass this intersection. It's the same thing for the salmon. They all come in these few channels here, and then they distribute themselves out through all of these waterways. And so a salmon farm like that Birdwood farm right there, right in the middle of this hub, ensures that every single salmon coming and going from this area is going to be exposed to whatever's coming out of that feedlot.
I was on an industry advisory panel when I worked for the Ministry of Environment back in the 90s, where the net pens were just getting started. And we had scuba divers that were going in, diving under the net pens, and these guys were just saying it was the amount of partially decomposed food and salmon feces at the bottom of these tanks. There was just basically no growth underneath these tanks, just white sewage fungus.
What you're doing is you're creating these massive, dense populations of salmon in one location. That's a perfect breeding ground. If we put massive numbers of people in one place or cattle, if we have disease problems, we have that with Atlantic salmon. And so we have almost a nursery ground or a factory for sea lice and diseases.
When salmon farms first came in, I begged the government to leave some of the migration routes open, but they didn't. And so now, I have watched juvenile salmon come out of the rivers, and they're beautiful. They're like silvery and blue, and they come along these farms and they get their first layer of sea lice. They go to the next farm, they get another layer of sea lice. And 20, 30 kilometers along the route, there was a place that I named the Bay of the Damned, because by the time those fish got there, the lice were so big, they were just sucking the life out of them. And then as the lice get bigger, and particularly the females with eggs, when they grab onto the fish, they poke right into it. And you can see these tracks as they move along the fish, these little black holes. And they destroy the fish.
After her research on sea lice, Alex focused on viruses, possibly originating from fish farms that may have affected wild fish. This unleashed a storm of controversy within the aquaculture industry, as well as the Canadian federal government.
A lot of these farm salmon that I'm looking at in supermarkets, I can't even believe people are eating them. Their flesh is dyed. They're fed a very, very high fat diet. So this is where the toxins, PCBs, bind to the fat molecules. So that's why the farm salmon are so heavily laden with PCBs. They lack any muscle tone to them at all. They are a completely different creature.
You know, when I was a little guy, I used to sit with my grandmother. It was actually my great-grandmother. And she had a little wooden smokehouse on the beach. And the old people, you would see them, and they were so happy when the salmon ran, whether it be the Nimkish River or the Kinkum River. And I think that's the same feeling I have. When I see the wild salmon coming back, it's a food I depend on. It's a food I love. I've tried that farm fish. I don't know. I wouldn't feed it to my cat if I owned a cat. And I just don't like what they've done with it to say this is going to replace our wild salmon. You cannot replace our wild salmon.
It really just occurred to me maybe 15 years ago,
to make a stand and to say, I am not going to serve anything but wild salmon. I just thought that, you know, the tourists came to Seattle, they want salmon, they don't really care what kind of salmon, they want salmon. And I was there to satisfy the people that came into my restaurant. When I got to be a little bit more mature about the whole fact and started thinking about, well, where's the salmon from? Or I started hearing things about the issues with farm salmon. I started to do my research, and that's when I started to it became more important to me to serve wild salmon. It became more important for me to be kind of a leader in my industry, to make sure that my customers who are running the board from, I don't really care, I just want a piece of fish, to I'm a fisherman in Alaska every season, and I really appreciate what you're doing here. It is not determined whether farm salmon is safe or not, not just as far as eating it, but as the way it's raised, getting out into the environment with the wild fish. There's nobody that can certify that at this point. But right now, the wild fishery is what's certified and sustainable and delicious.
And sales are up for farmed salmon in the United States, the single largest importer of Canada's farmed fish.
About this, Sir Edmund, owned by Cermaq, Norwegian government. This was the site of a huge IHN outbreak. This farm needs to go.
Every year we return from the great Pacific to our home waters to feed before the final push to our birth rivers. Our little ones flicker through these same rich waters on their way out to the open ocean. By the time the nets come into sight, the sea lice have bored into the thin skin of our smolts. Waste rains from inside the cages that block our migration routes. We see our foreign cousins in their pens and can do nothing. They see us and do not understand. They want to live as surely as we do, but the nets separate us until they don't. And when they escape, they come to our rivers, a place they were never meant to be.
Filed a lawsuit against the Canadian federal government for allegedly allowing virus-infected fish into open water net pens. Alex has been widely attacked by industry supporters for launching the suit. Marine Harvest is the Norwegian-owned salmon farming corporation allegedly involved with the release. They are the biggest salmon farming company in Canada and now the world. My request to interview representatives from Marine Harvest were turned down.
A lot of people, particularly right now, are saying to me, I cannot believe how long you've been in this fight. I mean, my hair was black when I started this. This was 20-odd years ago. We keep in this fight mainly because we have children. I mean, that is, you can't look your child in the face and say, I'm going to quit.
I don't have children of my own. But I do have nieces and nephews that I love very much. I often wonder what will be left for them. At one time, there were 30 to 60 million wild bison roaming the prairies of North America. Now less than 5,000, mostly confined to a park. It took white settlers all of 45 years to do this. Sometimes it feels pointless to question the inertia of human progress. The hard damn truth I can't get over is I'm part of what's happened to salmon. I fish for salmon. I turn on lights generated by dams that wiped out massive salmon runs. I choose to live in a region where we've ruined spawning streams to build our homes. I'm individually a part of what we've collectively done to salmon. And in the end, I don't know if it's possible to put things back the way they were. Next stop, further north, the Tongass National Rainforest, southeast Alaska. It's where I guided for the better part of my 20s and where I feel most alive, and where salmon are at the center of everything. The Tongass is the largest temperate rainforest left on Earth. There are more living organisms per square acre here than anywhere else, including the Amazon. When the sun decides to peek out, it just glows. Prince of Wales Island, or POW as the locals call it, is the most heavily logged swath of acreage in the Tongass. And when POW's forests went, so went the salmon, like chums, the fourth of our five Pacific species. Oncorhynchus keta, or dogs, all but disappeared from streams on POW when clear-cut logging took its toll on its salmon rivers, just like it did in the lower 48 United States. Old-growth forests were logged right to the riverbank. The trees that provided shade and anchored the banks were dragged across, through, up and down rivers, wiping out massive salmon nests, or reds. Logging in the Tongass continues today, not the massive clear-cuts of the past. But what remains from that era is a stark reminder of how quickly we can change the face of a landscape. There's salmon perspective, and then there's Ray Troll's salmon perspective. Ray Troll, for the uninitiated, brings to salmon art what Elvis brought to rock and roll. And his perspective is, well, it's Ray, man.
Here's a little mind-blowing thing for you. These are pectoral fins here. These are modified pectoral fins. We are from a clan of fish that left the water oh so many years ago, back in the Devonian. But basically, the animals with the backbones are variations on fish. We're the lobe fin tribe, they're the ray fin tribe. We should not separate ourselves. I'm also a paleo geek. You start looking at things in terms of deep time. What's cool about the Tongass, this little ribbon of green that tapers up the northwest coast, the salmon and the forest co-evolved. The isotopes of the salmon, they bring the nitrogen in from the ocean, and they're literally in the trees. So the trees contain the salmon. It's a salmon forest. So as an artist, that's really a surreal image to me. I just love this idea that, you know, they're like inside the trees, man. So my inner hippie is like, that is so cool. It's transformational. It's a trip, man. Blow your mind. It does, if you listen to it.
Once there was a fisherman who caught a small fry. The tiny salmon pleaded for his life, saying, "Put me back, and I'll return large enough to feed you properly." The fisherman replied,
"I would put you back.
And I would return. But this is a different story now."
Last stop, Bristol Bay, southwest Alaska. Oncorhynchus nerca, aka sockeye, are also called reds for their crimson spawning color. In Bristol Bay, they're referred to as red gold. Half the world's sockeye salmon supply comes from Bristol Bay.
The two things sockeye salmon need in freshwater is they need lakes, and Bristol Bay has a lot of lakes, and spawning gravel. And this is essentially a giant sponge-like layer of gravel. Everywhere you go, you have this gravel that's been laid down by the glaciers. You couldn't design a better place to produce sockeye salmon.
Bristol Bay is remote. Its main hub is Dillingham, with a full-time population under 2,500. Outlying smaller villages are even more remote and only accessed by boat or small aircraft. Three main players take the stage in Bristol Bay when it comes to fishing: subsistence, sport, and commercial fishermen. Subsistence fishing feeds body and soul of the people here, day in and day out, year round.
You catch the first fish in the spring when the king start running, and the first fish is always shared. Every year is always the same, the first salmon.
This spring, I set the net, and my nephew was sitting in there with me, and then we saw a fish, and we caught him. At that time, one of my sisters was dying from cancer, and I took that fish to her, offered her the first part of it. And the look in her eyes, it gave her life. Although brief that it was, but it was very moving. And how do you describe that spiritual feeling that you had, that we felt as though that we were invincible, that we were powerful? This was who we are.
With your family or extended family, you go out and you harvest fish and you put it up.
And then you'd get enough to last you a whole winter.
So we put up anywhere from 1,000+ fish a year.
Probably 10 cases of the quart jars of salmon.
I eat salmon just about every other day.
3-day smoke, my kippered salmon.
Dry canned.
You smoke them?
Salt fish.
Can them?
Caviar.
Salted.
Fresh fillets.
Salmon strips.
Jarred salmon for tuna fish. We use salmon instead of tuna fish, you know.
We're doing gum chops and heads.
I can't wait to boil that first head up with the eggs if it's a female.
King salmon.
You smoke it.
All that fat and all that juice. And
backbones.
Buried in the ground and fermented.
Salmon casseroles or salmon dip for crackers and chips and stuff like that.
And I consider
the oceans are
the river
our grocery
one
store.
Of our grocery stores.
You do it as a family activity, so it really connects you as a family.
You look forward to it every spring.
It means you share with others that don't have.
If you have food on your table, you keep your kids well fed, a solid roof, a warm house, you're wealthy. That's all that really matters, and anybody back home from my village will tell you that.
I firmly believe the reason we have the runs we do here is because the habitat is virtually the same as it was 1,000 years ago.
And with proper management, it should happen for thousands more.
Over $100 million a year is spent on the Bristol Bay sports fishery, with anglers coming from all over the world to spend their money chasing salmon and trout.
We have a lot of sport fishing that goes on here, but that's actually fairly new to the area. Since the mid to late 60s, it really gained a foothold.
Nancy Morris Lyon owns and operates Bear Trail Lodge and King Salmon on the southeast side of Bristol Bay. In 2008, Nancy co-founded the Bristol Bay Fly Fishing and Guide Academy, where she trains local young people to be professional fishing guides for free.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
That's it, chick. There That's you go. It. First try.
That's what I'm talking about.
Nip your end.
The thing about Bristol Bay that makes it so one of a kind is these large systems up here that are non-polluted are able to create an environment that could not be recreated by man.
Bristol Bay not only feeds its residents, it feeds the world. Its sockeye salmon fishery is the most productive on Earth, and it produces 14,000 jobs each year up and down the west coast of the United States, to the tune of $1.5 billion to the economy.
Bristol Bay arguably is the world's most dynamic fishery, and it's seen record returns in the last 30 years. It's proving itself to be a heavily commercially exploited fishery that is sustainable. We're blessed with an ecosystem that provides in abundance, and we have the ability to go in and responsibly harvest.
I've been doing it for 30 years, and my kids, Ricky does it, and Holly does it. It's in the family now. This is the way of life.
Salmon are protected as a resource in Alaska's constitution. Their management practices are based on the hard lessons learned in the lower 48 United States and are often considered the most sound in the world.
Fishermen are on board with that. I mean, that's our future.
Here, our agreement of old still stands, for now. But something is reaching below the surface. Not this water, but the land. Reaching for something older even than us, and to many of you, just as precious.
Now, a conflict that's been looming for decades is about to spill over here. It's a bitter fight over the predominance of two of Bristol Bay's most precious resources. Pebble refers to a vast body of copper ore known as the Pebble Deposit. The Pebble Limited Partnership is proposing a mine that would dig an open pit 3.2 miles wide and 4,000 feet deep in the headwaters of Bristol Bay salmon country. Pebble CEO contends they could mitigate for any problems encountered with a mine and fishery trying to coexist.
There's no such thing as a no-risk mine. You can mitigate those risks, and that's what we have to do.
But
and
why even contemplate taking risks right here in such a unique environment?
This isn't a unique environment. This environment exists over a huge area, over the size of states.
Sure, but we're talking about a watershed which runs into the Bristol Bay, which is the world's greatest wild salmon run, period. It is unique.
Right. People think that we can destroy the whole fishery. We cannot do that. The amount of material that we're taking out, even if it all escaped, which is not possible to have all of it escape, would not destroy the fishery.
Rick Halford served as an Alaska State Senator for 25 years. He's also logged more than 10,000 hours over Alaska as a private pilot and hunting guide. He's a proud Republican and a life member of the National Rifle Association. Today, Rick is a paid consultant for Trout Unlimited, an outspoken critic of the proposed Pebble Mine. In all his years as a senator, there was never an Alaskan mining proposal he didn't like.
I was very much in favor of resource development. With a small population of Alaska, we felt and still do feel in general that resource development is one of the legs of the economic stool that keeps our state going. When I first heard about Pebble, I didn't really know much about it, so I was ambivalent or positive. It wasn't until an elder in Western Alaska that I ran into when I was stuck there in lousy weather in Equok named Lukey Acklecock, I asked me to look at it. I started to look.
What's important to understand about copper mines, low-grade copper mines, is that most of them have been developed throughout the world in deserts.
Over 99% of everything that's mined stays on the site as waste, either waste rock and or tailings. When those minerals are exposed to air and water, sulfuric acid is produced, and that's acid mine drainage. The real problem with the acid is it puts all these other metals that are in the deposit into solution.
Copper is one of the most toxic elements to salmon. There's always a natural level of copper based on the rocks, et cetera, in the area. But slight increases above natural can wipe out a salmon's ability to smell. And salmon use their sense of smell to find their way home, to spawn, to the streams that they're adapted to, and them straying to a different stream because they can't find their home stream could result in them not being successful reproductively.
So how would you store nearly 11 billion tons of waste material from a copper mine?
They would have to be perpetual storage of toxic material in an enormous tailings pond, and the term pond is questionable because it would be some 700 feet deep, so it's really much more than a pond, with the dam the length of the Three Gorges Dam in China holding back toxic material stored in perpetuity.
Just the fact that you're going to have the tailings and the dams and somebody's going to have to monitor that forever, that just don't make sense to me.
We, the people who are designing dams, who have been doing this basically for 50 plus years, can build a dam now that's going to last in perpetuity. I think there's a little arrogance in that statement.
You have to recognize that you're in the area of moral responsibility for generations way, way out there. When you talk about perpetual remediation, you're talking about the kind of word that should be used in church, not in science. If God were playing with us, he couldn't have picked a more critical location, because this drains both ways into the two biggest drainages.
Not only that, but the pebble deposit is sort of in the high point of the topography. And of course, gravity wants to move things downhill.
If we look at the Akiteti mine down in New Guinea, it was a big copper and gold mine that had a massive tailings dam in a steep, wet, potentially unstable area upstream of the Fly River. And it failed catastrophically. It basically poisoned the river downstream, wiped out the fishery there. That mine was built with all the assurances, had all the modern technology, had all the modern safeguards. Nothing could possibly go wrong. They would spare no expense in terms of the environmental analysis. And they did a lot of work on it. But when push came to shove and the unforeseeable actually happened, the consequence was tremendous.
And on August 4th, 2014, the tailings dam at the Mount Polley mine in British Columbia failed, sending billions of gallons of mine waste into salmon-bearing systems connected to the Fraser River. Once again, the mine operators assured the public that every environmental safeguard had been put into place prior to this unimaginable event ever happening. The same company that built the tailings dam at Mount Polley also designed the proposed Pebble Mines tailings dam. It would be six times taller. Something like this happening once is a disaster. Happening twice looks more like a pattern.
It wouldn't take a mine failure to affect the landscape here. The daily operation of the mine itself would permanently change the character of this place. To run the mine, 94 miles of streams would be lost. Pebble would require an 86-mile transportation corridor with a gravel road and four pipelines, and would need to build its own massive power plant, deep water port facility, and would use 35 billion gallons of water annually, more than the city of Anchorage. To put this in perspective, the Johnson Creek watershed in Portland is 26 miles long. The Elwha River restoration will open up roughly 70 miles of pristine salmon habitat. The Lower Snake River's four dams block this much salmon wilderness. That's 5,500 square miles. The breached Mount Polley tailings dam sits in the Quesnel watershed, which is more than 4,500 square miles. It released 4 billion gallons of mine waste downstream. Bristol Bay's watershed is a wetland that stretches across 40,000 square miles, about the size of Kentucky, with nine major rivers flowing through it. Copper is at the foundation of society. You'll find it in nearly everything that makes modern life possible, including every Bristol Bay fishing boat. There's copper in its electronics, its engine, even bottom paint. There are untapped copper deposits all over the earth, even under the ocean. These deposits can be hard to reach and would be expensive to mine, but the fact is they do exist.
We have roads, we have foundations, and those come from mines, and those come from gravel pits. And so for us, we're not opposed to mining.
I have nothing against mining, and I want to make that really clear. People think, oh, you're anti-mining. No, I'm not. My father used to work in mines. However, it's such a huge risk because honestly, we have not really done a good job with copper mines throughout the United States at all. We've wiped out fisheries, we've contaminated water, and I just don't see good examples that we can use to say, it'll be like this one.
Here's the facts that we know that are not going to change. We know generally the size of the deposit. We know the makeup of the deposit, and we know the location. And those three facts of size, type or scope, and location are cause for great concern of the people in Bristol Bay.
Protects the clean water and
a coalition devoted to keeping a mine out of Bristol Bay tries Alaskan state politics with an initiative that would make it more difficult for a mine like Pebble to be built in Bristol Bay. Prop 4 was the most costly initiative in state history, and it failed.
The state is just dying to believe the thousand-year-old lie that you can have both in the case of mining and fisheries.
And it looks like we're being set up by our own state. I think the state will permit Pebble Mine regardless. And for the 8,000 residents that live here, we're not the chosen few that's going to benefit out of Pebble.
With Proposition 4 defeated, several fishing groups and Bristol Bay tribes reach out to the United States Environmental Protection Agency to intervene.
Six tribes contacted them to invoke the 404C.
The EPA asserts it has the authority under Section 404C of the Clean Water Act to preemptively shut down a mine before it's even in the official permitting process if it determines the mine will do harm to water and wildlife.
Instead of invoking it, they decided they were going to be doing the scientific assessment, which I fully support.
In May 2012, the United States Environmental Protection Agency released the first draft of their Bristol Bay Watershed Assessment. They found in their hypothetical mining scenario that a mine like Pebble would impact fish and fish habitat, both through daily operations and potential mine failure situations. The Pebble Limited Partnership quickly condemned the report, calling it unprecedented and legally dubious. A public hearing generates debate over how Pebble plans to contain acid-generating pyrite.
Could you tell us perhaps a little bit more about the distribution of pyrite?
Because there's no mine plan yet, I don't really know if I can answer that question.
This Pebble discussion has been going on since 1985. And if there's no plan in place, why are we still discussing? Just idea or notion that there's no plan. Maybe it's not true.
The Pebble Limited Partnership spent 8 years and $120 million producing its 27,000-page environmental baseline document. With all the mountains of data and swirling opinions, there was one key thing missing: Pebble's official mine plan.
What I've seen over the past decade in particular is that mining companies don't want to release full data sets and reports in front of the permitting process where they have to release it, because they know that people like me are going to review it and scrutinize it and critique it. And they don't want to give me the time and opportunity to do that. If the permitting process begins, I think ultimately that the mine will be approved.
Public hearings are held to discuss the EPA assessment from both sides of the argument.
The draft Bristol Bay Watershed Assessment Process and any potential 404C actions
which may result from it are of concern at this time, because not only is the process rushed and premature, but there is not even a single permit application regarding development of Pebble in front of the state or federal governments. A preemptive veto of the Pebble project is no different than a preemptive approval.
We're happy to contribute all the data that we have. In fact, we'd be happy to examine data presented by the Pebble Partnership. The more data you see, the farther you proceed with the science, the more certain you'll become this is not something that you should allow. You're the Environmental Protection Agency. We're counting on you to live up to your name, protect our environment. Thank you.
The Environmental Protection Agency was created by President Nixon in 1970, spawned from public concern over the health of America's air and water. The first head of the EPA was Bill Ruckelshaus, who had to hit the ground running when he was appointed by the president.
I mean, we had terrible water pollution problems. We had flammable rivers in Lake Erie. The Cuyahoga River caught on fire going out through Cleveland into Lake Erie. Lake Erie was declared dead in those days because of eutrophication. We had air pollution problems. Those were smell, touch, and feel kind of pollution problems that led to public demand that something be done. And President Nixon took the initiative to form the Environmental Protection Agency because the states weren't very good regulators of the activities of industry in particular because they competed so strongly for industry within their borders. So EPA is sort of held up as the epicenter of hell in the regulatory field of the environment at the national level. In my view, the two are intertwined, the economy and a clean environment. If you have bad air or bad water, it costs a lot of money.
There are said to be something like 10 billion tons of copper ore below our feet. Give me a ballpark figure of how much that could be worth to your company.
Well, the total in-place value that people have talked about is in the $300 to $500 billion range. But
hang on, just run that by me again. You're talking about $500 billion potentially,
but,
of copper below.
But you don't get that for free.
But that is one heck of an incentive for you to do whatever it takes to get that stuff out.
No, you know, actually it's the other way around. Because what it does, if you, in order to build a mine in a place like this, you need a big resource. That's what gives you the opportunity to spend the money that you need to spend to protect the environment and mine at the same time.
It's this earth and this water that protects you and us. This is our life source. And we in turn offer one last act of love back to this life source so it can continue. Seems to me it's you that needs the protecting from you.
Well, of course, corporations are by their nature fiduciary instruments for the concentration of capital. Their job for their shareholders is to maximize profit, and they are not morally created entities. They have no soul, they have no heart, but they have immortality. The shareholders of Alaska and the shareholders in the public trust of the land of North America have a much greater calling to stand up for the future than the short-term gain of corporations in their fiduciary world.
Well, what really hurts, you know, Pebble is coming into the villages and buying them up. You know, taking them and giving them a good time, and they're kind of dividing the people.
That's the way these companies work worldwide. It's divide a community, it's reward your friends, penalize your enemies, and go forward.
After more than 3 years of work, including two peer reviews and two rounds of public comment, the EPA published their final watershed assessment on January 15th, 2014. Their conclusion? A hard rock mine the size and scope of Pebble would cause harm to the salmon, habitat, and people of Bristol Bay. It also focused in on the subsistence way of life Native Alaskans have survived on for at least 4,000 years. Salmon is the food that feeds them year-round, and that is equal to whatever dollars they might earn.
And while jobs are absolutely important and necessary, they're not the end-all, be-all in order for a community to survive. Yes, we need more economic diversification, but it's not as easy for an outsider to understand as to why or how much unless they've really lived in that community or they've spent significant time in that community.
Pebble pushes back on the final watershed assessment, insisting it shouldn't be used in any decision-making by the EPA. They make a change at their highest ranks, hiring Tom Collier as their new CEO. He's a respected Washington, D.C. lawyer and former chief of staff to the Department of the Interior, specializing in EPA permitting. Mr. Collier states that any EPA preemptive action against Pebble would be an overreach of their authority. What is EPA's actual track record with industrial permitting? The Army Corps of Engineers estimate they receive 60,000 dredge and fill 404 permit applications a year. That's roughly 2,520,000 times since 1972, the year the Clean Water Act passed. Since then, the EPA has used their veto power 13 times. And now 14 is possible, as the EPA initiates the 404C process, which could preemptively shut down Pebble. A backlash erupts from mine proponents and Alaskan politicians. Pebble asserts this would be the first preemptive veto of a project and is therefore illegal, also suggesting that state sovereignty is at risk, not just in Alaska, but for everyone in the United States.
You know, we have so much political push today for freedom, and who's against freedom? Freedom is not do whatever you want to do as long as your neighbor's head is not lopped off. But freedom is a system of restraints. Freedom is not the absence of restraint. That's license.
There's only 8,000 of us in Bristol Bay. We don't have the dollars to go up against a company that, you know, they could buy anybody they want, politicians, whoever, and we're doing everything we can to stop this mine.
Two U.S. senators introduced legislation that could strip the EPA of their 404C veto power. And U.S. Senator Lisa Murkowski from Alaska backs it, echoing the charges that the EPA is overstepping its authority.
Thank you, sir.
You know, 50 years from now, I don't want to look back and see a huge open pit mine and say that I didn't try to stop it.
I reached out to Pebble, mining proponents in the business sector, and mine-backing Alaskan politicians multiple times. No one would grant me an interview.
The state of Alaska's not listening. Pebble's not listening. Things are stacked up against us.
The question always boils down to, can mining and salmon coexist? What do you think?
No!
No, 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 no. Not no, hell no!
No!
Pebble sues the EPA, citing it has overstepped its constitutional boundaries.
The people of Bristol Bay are sick and tired of the uncertain fate of our watershed. That is why the time to act is now.
On the other side of Congress, two members of the House of Representatives introduced another bill that would strip the EPA of its veto power.
One mistake and that cauldron starts to seep into our water, into the fish, and killing these important jobs. We know what the answer is. Stop Pebble Mine.
Do you value essentially a salmon fishery that could last forever more than you value the amount of gold that could actually be pulled out of the ground? Now, obviously, the people trying to propose the mine are going to have a different answer than the fishermen. The real question is how society wants to balance those and view those. And in looking back at the history, we don't have a very good track record of actually erring on the side of protecting the fish as a resource. And if we don't get Alaska right, we may have a clean sweep of getting it wrong.
If we're successful at engaging the national conscience as to what's at stake in the Pebble debate. The people of Alaska, the people of the United States, will never allow a mine to risk what's there.
So if my father has stood up for protecting this area and for this fishery, then I have to do it and my children will have to do it, because that ore body is not going to go away. So we all have to do what's right, not only for our future, but our future children have to do what's right. And if technology is not there for them to safely extract that ore from that ground, then they will have to fight it.
For now, Bristol Bay's wild salmon continue the thrum of their tailbeats upriver, as they have for the last 10,000 years, finding their way home. Once you were so many you couldn't be counted. Now, may you who remain return for those who will remain after me.
It's long been said there's a deep wisdom inside us. Each one of our runs unique, each home river unique, but a deep wisdom shared by all wild salmon. And even if we continue to fade, this is my truest hope, this wisdom. We know just what to do. We just need the river to do it. We return every year not for profit, but for the quick silver flame flickering underwater in the dead of winter. We return for life to continue, and always will, so long as we're able. And this, in turn, is my hope for you. If you mean what you say and you wish us to stay, as you work to save us, it may turn out that we end up saving you.